Next talk will be delivered by Sri Sunil Kumar Singh, who is basically a petroleum engineering graduate from Indian School of Mines, Dhanbad, now IIT, ISM, Dhanbad. He started his professional career as a drilling engineer for ONGC and SR Oil Limited. Subsequently, he worked as a stimulation engineer in well stimulation services of ONGC, Ahmedabad, till 99, followed by a stint of joint venture group of ONGC. Sri Singh joined Directorate General of Hydrocarbons in 2013 and had been coordinator of major producing sharing contracts. Currently, he holds the responsibility of Head of Department of Alternative Energy and Department of PEL PML Group in DGH. One of the major responsibilities as HOD includes implementation of national program for new energy resources like coal-based methane, gas hydrate, shale gas and oil. He is also associated with number of policy formulation for the contract regimes such as pre-NELP, NELP and HELP. So with this brief introduction, I request Sri Sunil Kumar Singh sir to deliver his talk on policy and regulatory issues of UCG in India. Sri Singh sir, please.
So first of all, I would like to thank Mr. Singh again that giving me this opportunity to speak to you on this topic. Of course, many of you are already aware about some of the regulations which are there for your coal mines, and there are regulations for petroleum industry as well. In that context, I actually tried to find if there is any reference or policy and regulation for UCG in anywhere in the world. And what I have come to know that there is not much literature or much reference as far as UCG is concerned. But probably India could be the leader, at least in this field, that it is very actively pursuing to formulate policy and regulation for UCG. So probably India may be the leading country in the world in that respect. As a matter of fact, our Honorable Minister has informed the Parliament that a model contract is under preparation. Now I'm mentioning you CBM policy and regulation, and I'm mentioning you with a purpose. See, if you are trying to create a policy and a regulation regime for a new entity, new mineral type at least, like UCG, then it's always better to have a reference which has some similarity in nature, in the way it is produced, in terms of the phase of the product that you are talking about. Say, syngas is a gas, CBM is also a gas. It is also somewhere linked to coal. So there is a lot of relevance. So you can look up at CBM policy and regulation, and you can draw some framework in which you can work and finalize a policy and regulation regime for UCG. Now I'm just trying to go through very quickly about the basic thing about policy and regulation regime in any country, anywhere in the world, is the topmost thing is the constitution. Next comes the law, then comes the rules, finally it is the policy and contracts. They differ, of course, that you can see, I have given some color, that depicts the kind of detail which is there. In constitution, there is just a reference, there is not much of a detail. Law has a slightly more detail, and finally the policy and contracts, they are very detailed. As a matter of fact, for policy and contracts, it should cover every possible eventualities that might occur, say if you are running this contract for 10 years or 20 years. So all possibilities should be covered. Now I'm just giving you an example of constitutional control, because you have to frame your policy and regulation within what constitution says about your mineral. So it is appearing in a state list as well as in the union list. But it is very beautifully synthesized in our country, that though it is appearing in both the list, but it's the union government which is responsible for framing policy and regulation in our country. Though it is a fact, it is the state government which issues or gives you or grants you the permit, but they grant you the permit under the rules and regulation which have been framed by the center. Similarly, you can have an example of law. Law is also, it's not a very elaborate document, it's a very brief document. Many of the laws has hardly one or two or three pages. Say for example, but they are very critical for framing any rules, regulation, policy for any mineral. So for example, I'll give you one example of Mines and Minerals Act 1957. There, the minerals and mineral oil are defined. So these are only two very simple statements, but they have such a, imposing impact that they are the genesis of formation of two ministries, as a matter of fact. There is a Ministry of Mines, which looks after A, and there is a Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas, which looks after B, because of these two sentences written in the Mines and Minerals Act, 1957. Now, I'm giving you a detail, and here I will stay for some time. Because it will, some of the details here I will be talking probably will reveal some of the features of this framework that exist in any kind of rules and regulations for any minerals. Now, you can see at the topmost level, this is a law. But in bracket, it is written parliament. That's very important. It gives a lot of characteristics to law. The very important thing is that you cannot ask parliament to enact law every year, every 5 years or 10 years. The point is very simple, that whatever you write here, it should be very brief, very crisp, to the point, very objective. And probably there is not much of detail in the law. Because you can see our Petroleum Industry ORD Act, that is the Oil Industry Regulation Development Act 1948, stands there for I think more than half century. And I'm very confident that probably it will even last for another 50 years or so. So acts are written in such a manner that it's not required to be changed frequently. More often. The rules are slightly easier. Rules are framed by, and of course, rules are drawn from the law. Rules are essentially the subset of law. And they are written by respective ministries. But those rules subsequently have to be simply ratified by the parliament. It is not to be, decided, only to be ratified. So it is slightly less stricter, and therefore you have some details out there. In rules you will find, they define you what will be the deadhead fee, what should be the size of your mines, for how long. Those details are existing in rules. But rules and law together is what the authority of parliament that you have to administer a particular mineral. Now coming to policy. Policy differs to rules and law in the sense, whereas law and rules are very generic. It talks about, say, the total spectrum of minerals, total spectrum of hydrocarbon, every possible form of hydrocarbon, whether it is a conventional hydrocarbon, it is CBM, it is gas hydrate, shale gas iron. So all things together, they deal with it. But when you come to the policy, it comes to the component level. You deal with a specific mineral. For a specific mineral, you should have a policy. Nowadays, as a matter of fact, it's not only the mineral, we have policies for different sets of minerals. For example, shale gas is a hydrocarbon, methane, CBM is also a hydrocarbon, but we do have different policies because they are different in the manner they exist. And they're, so separate, so distinguished that you have to have two different sets of policies. Now, the final product that comes out from the policy is the contract. That is a document of about 100 or 150 pages. Now, this is very detailed document. Here, you should be able to you know, visualize every possible eventuality in, say, 10 or 20 years ahead. And that's why I told you that when you are drawing contract, you should draw it from some reference, because that reference has been tested for some decades. For example, CBM contracts have been tested for, I think, for 17 years now. So you are pretty confident about the provisions written out there. So it would be always better that whenever you are drawing your this policy or contracts for UCG, then you should have a reference, and in my case, I have drawn it from the CBM. Now finally, it is the supplementary policy. See, when you run a contract, we have run the contract of CBM for about 15, 20 years now. But whatever we thought and we presumed, we say in 2000, was not all true. So we came across a situation where there was no provision contained in the contract that could address the problem that we faced. And because of that, we have, I think, 5-6 contracts, which has just stopped. It's not progressing. So naturally, we have to come up to address those issues in a separate policy. So I'm giving you one example that for CBM, we are now coming up with an 11-point CBM policy, which is almost at the final stage of getting approved. So this is the structure in which we have also to draw something, a contract, probably a contract. Another point that I wanted to tell you about the more than an individual contract. Now, what happened earlier, right, when we started privatizing our minerals for extraction, we were executing individual contracts with different parties. Then we came to know that there are discrepancies, some changes in the way you have written your provisions. So that brought up a lot of controversies and disputes. So subsequently, what we thought of, that we should first write a model contract, and subsequently, when we are actually signing with a particular entity, we will only cosmetically change some of the provisions. For example, the name of the contractor, the addresses of the contractor, while keeping everything intact. And it's very important, otherwise you will not be in a position to monitor and administer a set of contracts. For example, in UCG, you are planning, I think, 6-7 contracts. So it's always better to have a model contract. Now, our older days were very nice. There was not much to think about, because when somebody referred to you or the coal, you just visualize that there is one coal that I have to, physically mine it, either through open blast or underground mines. There's no complex systems involved. But subsequently, because of the technology and new methods which are coming, the same mineral are now being looked at very, very differently. And in some cases, very different. Say, even for coal, you have got three things. Now, you can directly mine it physically. You can go for UCG. You can go for coal-based methane. Similar in the case, in the case of hydrocarbon. Earlier, we were only, dealing with conventional hydrocarbon, which was present in sandstone or carbonate rock. But now the technology has expanded our horizon. Now, we are even looking hydrocarbon in shale. We are looking in hydrocarbon in CBM, and I think after a decade or so, probably we will also be looking at the hydrocarbon available with the gas hydrate. So the point is, these things brings about the issues that for a piece of land, whether you should give a lease for one individual for one mine, one mineral, or to one individual for three minerals. So there's a complexities creeping in into the very structure of policy and regulation. I will deal with right now, and I will tell you, in certain situation, it's better to unify everything together. And in certain situation, it's better to segregate them. For example, in the case of hydrocarbon, you might have heard that the government of India has promulgated a new policy called hydrocarbon exploration licensing policy, 1950. They are trying to combine all forms of hydrocarbon together. They want to give the mining lease, the petroleum mining lease, to an individual company for all four variations of hydrocarbon. So that is a unification approach. Why it is there? That's a different thing that we shall argue about subsequently. But in the case of coal, I think logically it is better that we treat them separately. Probably why? Probably we might not be doing physical mining together with UCG. We probably might not be doing UCG at the same time as CBM. But such things are possible in hydrocarbon. So here, my suggestion is that if when, I mean, you think about UCG, you think about a single entity as a mineral. Don't try to combine it with other mineral. So it becomes very important. Say your law and rules might have only defined coal. Will it be suffice for you? Or you'd like to have a separate definition for UCG? So there is a question of general and specific, and I believe in the case of coal, you have a specifically tell and define UCG. Then only you can give right to a particular entity with respect to a certain aspect of mineral that you are thinking about. Then there is a question of multiple vertical right. In old times, there was only one agencies having vertical rights. But as I have explained today, now we are very quickly moving to era where we may be required to give multiple vertical rights to a single entity. Now, again, there is a question of prioritizing what you want to extract. These questions come many times. In a particular area, it may be endowed with petroleum resources, it may be endowed with coal resources and many other resources. So there has to be a body to decide what you want to extract, which is the most beneficial. For example, in Gondwana area, if there is CBM and there is a competition between, say, CBM and physical mining, I think physical mining has a priority. So that kind of preferences you have to decide. Then new things will come and that will make your life a little more difficult. Now, as far as UCG is concerned, now I will ask you one question. Is co-development possible? Can you mine two things together with UCG?
Yes, yes.
Which one, sir?
Tembevision.
No, which one? You can simultaneously operate with two minerals. It's not about the existence. It's about giving the right so that they are exploited at the same time.
At the same time, especially if we go to the Mehsana, in Kembe Basin, oil and coal, both can be exploited, coal can be exploited.
Yeah, but I'm talking specifically with UCG.
Yes, yes, coal in the form of UCG can be exploited. We are having over 40 meters.
Fine, fine, you can exploit it. Can you do this, another mineral also, at the same time?
At the same time,
it will not be possible. So if you issue a mining lease, it is a sequential thing, one after another.
One after another.
That is possible, but you cannot do the same thing.
Yes, sir.
He's asking about simultaneously. That is not possible.
I'm referring to what you say. What exactly I'm saying that at the same time, can you allow two things to happen, UCG and CBM, or UCG with a conventional hydrocarbon?
Sequentially, it's possible.
Physical mining of coal? I think no. Yeah, you can do it sequentially. So, coal development is ruled out for UCG. Okay? Now, UCG, as we have already discussed, you have to give exclusive vertical right. Everything in the language, which is existing in PNG rules and other rules, they say that you are giving right to a particular entity to enjoy mineral. Enjoy. So you are giving exclusive right whenever you are giving a right for UCG. Now, there, how will you frame this word? Okay. So you have to write, so like in CBM, we have written that this PML is valid for CBM only, specifying to the contractor that you are not supposed to exploit any other mineral which might exist in vertical direction. The similar would be the case with UCG. Moreover, somewhere See, you can regulate, you can write your policies, you can frame rules and regulations at many places, as I have said. You can do some tweaking in law, you can do some tweaking in rules, you can do some tweaking in policy. Policy, of course, is not implementable in court. Contract is the binding. So there also you can write. And you can write that you retain the right to other means. And with particularly with UCG, if you are giving lease, you have to be careful about this, what it is. Because this is a very tricky thing, you know. If you write it wrong, you will be stuck with the period of contract. Say, like CBM is 38 years contract. If you write it wrong, you are stuck there itself. You will not be able to do anything with other minerals. So you should be very careful in your thinking. What about that? See, I want to tell you the nature of contract is very, very closely related to the nature of resource you have. See, the contract of physical mining, the contract of CBM, the contract of natural hydrocarbon, they are different regime. Why? Because the resources have different nature. How? Coal, for example, you can definitely know that coal exists. And you definitely know, even to the satisfaction of 95%, that this value of coal exists. Can you say this? The same thing with hydrocarbon. It is your luck. You have some scientific lead, but it doesn't mean that you will encounter a discovery and encounter a substantial discovery. It's not guaranteed. In coal, it is guaranteed. So the nature of contract of coal has to be different to the nature of hydrocarbon. Okay, now where is the UCG? Actually, I'm here. Oh, I'm sorry, whether I have to know, I'm very, very wrong. It should be UCG anyway. I'm here because I was part of a committee which was asked to recommend a price of seam gas and to recommend a structure for revenue sharing. And I had gone to CMPDI and I was with Mr. Singh and all, but that's why I'm here. What I realized that UCG, you can fairly evaluate it, its magnitude, what magnitude of resource you have. Naturally, your contract has to be closer to the contract which is definitive in nature. Say, for example, for CBM, do you ask the contractor to explore? You know the coal exists. Right, you don't ask him to explore. There is no clauses for discovery of well.
There is some problem if you cannot estimate gasifier reserve for UCD. There is no consistent policy throughout the world.
Now I'm coming to that. That's why I have
reserve. You know, some expert, different expert follow different techniques.
Okay.
Somebody will say I will leave 3% for fault. Somebody will say.
But certainly it is not as uncertain as petroleum, number one. Number one. Second is, that's why I have put a word contingent. Because it's the differing perceptions of different technologies around the world. What is the contingent resource? I think the UCG is a contingent resource. It requires to be validated by some commercial projects, yes, and in quite good numbers. Unless it is so, it would remain a contingent resource subject to contingencies involved with technology. That's what the point you are just indicating. But still, it is closer to the definite kind of system. And when it is a definite kind of system, the contract is not structured the way it is structured for hydrocarbon, where there is exploration. So you have exploration phase and exploitation phase. In CBM, there is one testing phase of 3 years, then pilot testing of another 3 years, then development of 5 years, followed by production phases. What about UCG? You need to have a pilot phase. Now, the duration has to be decided by the technical. I believe somebody has informed me that it could be a 3 years. So there will be two phases. You can name it the way you want. You can name it a pilot phase, or a full scale phase, or a production phase, or a development plus production phase. Then this also requires to think about whether you are required to give license or lease or both. In hydrocarbon, you are required to do both. In CBM, you are only required to do lease. The moment production is involved, then you only have to think about lease. Okay? So even if there is a pilot stage, the production is involved there. So you need not worry about license. Now, there is a very special aspect of UCP there. That in no other industry, mostly whatever mining you do, it is ultimately you can sell it in the open market. Right? What about syngas? I have been informed that syngas will be quickly utilized in the very vicinity where you are producing. So it is not something, am I right or?
Syngas cannot be utilized as such because it has to be purified first.
No, I'm talking.
It has got a lot of impurities. First, that is to be removed. It has to be in salable condition so that customer can use it.
Jain sir, mic thoda use kar.
This syngas, raw syngas cannot be used by customers. Nobody will use because it has S2S, CO2 and suspended solids. It has to be first processed and make it salable. And its calorific value is very low. It is 1/10 of natural gas. So it has to be, in terms of calorific value also, it has to be increased. Then only you will find customer, otherwise nobody will come.
I understand your point, but my point is
that expert have suggested that you have to integrate UCG with some end usage, proper end usage, either power or chemical or fertilizer, then only it will be feasible commercially.
That is the point I am trying to tell you, convey, that it has to be processed before use, but I am not actually talking about that aspect. I am talking about market, transported for 100 kilometers. Is it possible?
It's also not advisable to market.
No, it is not possible. Right? That's what the word hardwire is. That whenever you are making a contract, you are making a policy, it is almost tied up with its uses. Such is not the case with the coal. You produce a shell in Gujarat. Right?
Yes, coal also requires a transportation.
I'm just, don't take it as an exception, but we are transporting. It's a market to. Right? Now gas, similarly, you can transport from any point to any point. Can you do it with the same gas? I'm not talking on the exception, I'm talking on the general understanding of the
system.
Yeah, that's the point I'm saying. And that's why the end use has to be very close. Some of the experience. Sorry. See, when you are talking of contracts, I don't know how many of you are dealing with the contracts. Mostly we are the people from public sector, but we now have some exposure of dealing with private people through the contracts. Now there are two policies. Whenever we deal with the contracts, our mindset has to change. The first is, the first objective, of course, from the government side is that you don't start a contract and put a condition which undermines the value of natural resource, which is the property of the people of this country. So this is the first objective. The second objective is the enabling business, which requires some changes in our mindset. Because we are not only just to protect my resource, But the fact of reality, ground reality, is that any contractor which you ask him to do job for you, some profit is involved. So you should be ready that he will be taking some profits. And you should always think in, not in terms of just regulating it for the heck of it, but for continuing the business for the period of the contract. So what exactly it means, that sometimes you have to shut your eyes. Now, this is the period of contract. It appears very innocent, but this is, this provision, as a matter of fact, gives you the enabling power to control how your contracts will run. First is that either you can have a closed system, you can specify a particular number of years that this contract is valid for 10 years, or you can have an open system also, where you say that you will run this contract till economic life. When then, that is a very subjective kind of thing which can be disputed. So it is always better advised that you go for a fixed period of time which will be decided by the technical people who have experience. Say particularly if you give a mines of 50 tons, so you have to estimate how many years it will take. So with the help of technical people, you can start with a closed system, giving some provision for of extension, and that I will come in the last. Now for phases also you determine period. Period gives you a tool that your contract proceed in a manner that you have considered thought. Say suppose you have thought that the pilot phase will continue for 3 years, but it may be, because it's a theoretical understanding as on today. Nobody has seen it on the ground. And for any reasons, it is possible that your pilot will not be concluded in 3 years. Then what? You wouldn't say that contractor, you leave the place because he has invested his precious money into your contract. So you need to have some provisions to extend it reasonably. And there are hundreds of ways to extend it. You can extend a phase compensating in another following phase. You can extend a phase asking some money. That is the liquidated damages, because you have delayed the project. So that way you can control how the contract progresses. Now the start of the contract is also very important. You can say that I have today signed a contract with you, so your contract starts now. So your contract will end after 10 years. Is it justifiable? No. Because though you have signed the contract, but have you given him the money lease? Money lease is not, you know, issued in a day. It takes time. So it should be the day of execution of money lease. But in your case, I believe in UCG, it's not even the money lease. It could be when your end user is ready. If your end user is not ready, what you will do with producing syngas? So you have to think these aspects, and then you have to specify when the contract will start. So there are other excusable delays and all, since we don't have much of time, so I will move on. So I have already talked about controlling through a start time and period of phases and contract etc. Now you can again impose bank guarantee. Say in our case, you will get money lease. The point is that it takes time. It's not issued, you know, the moment you apply.
It should not be linked with the end user.
No, you have not done it. Okay. Let me go back. What I'm saying that there can be many considerations which will decide when the we will assume that my contract has started. In say hydrocarbon case, it is the day when the money is issued. What I am trying to tell you there, if that is also not enough. Say suppose I have issued findings and you have started producing syngas, is it good enough? The point here is that it has to be utilized. It's a very, very special situation.
Generally, pilot, human pilot, you go for flaring of the syngas. So no end user.
You have to think those things. If there's substantial flue gas the government will not like that you are burning the precious coal and just flaring it. So you have to think. And whatever best you can think, it is a technical consideration. Now about bank guarantee, normally when somebody subcontractor services the bank, I mean work program, we say that you give us bank guarantee 10% of the value that the work program you have committed. Just to make sure that if he doesn't put his money, because he might certainly have to cold fail because of any number of reasons. So this kind of assurance, and this is very important, submission and approval of development plan. It is a very critical matter, and this is what you are actually having this contract. See, the problem is that the contractor might get cold feet at any point of time. He may do the pilot test and all of a sudden he will feel that I should not pursue it. So the decision has to be very, very clear, and this clarity is brought out at the stage of development plan. When he is, see, all these words are different. Submission is different. Making the contractor to submit it. Approving it is a different issue, stage. So you can put some condition here. Within such and such date, you have to get approve it. Within such and such date, you have to submit your development plan. And you control it. And then also, say suppose the development plan has been approved, and you find that even for 2 years, he's doing nothing. Then what? Okay, in this case of minimum mindset, actually fortunately your act itself provides that if nothing is done for 4 years, his licenses and lease will be cancelled. So there your fortune is not so eventually. And similarly, though it is a kind of a very surprising that a contractor has invested everything, he has done the development, but still he might not produce it. I have a case. Ashwini, we do have a case of I should not name the contractor, where, I mean, development has taken place, all, I mean, transmission pipelines have been laid, but still they are not producing. And unfortunately, we don't have any clause in our contract to force him to produce. Now, such case is because of very low price of the gas. The contractor feels that probably if I wait for 1 or 2 years, I might get better price. So there should be some provision also to make contractors start producing. See whether so there is that a specific thing that I told, you can very specify clearly that if you don't do this and that, then I will consider that your lease has been withdrawn or something like that. So, and this is this appears very simple, but it has got a very commercial relevance, and you should be kind of sanctum about this measuring aspects. There may be lot of arbitration and cases are because of this measurement issues, like where is the delivery point. See, one very important thing is that while defining the delivery point, you should realize that the reality is calculated at wellhead. So, and there is a dispute, I mean, they have spent a lot of money between the wellhead and the delivery point. So that becomes a contentious issue. So what we have now doing, that we are fixing it. Okay, let's 10% you have spent between the 2 points. Don't argue, don't dispute. And then in this same case, we are very all aware that robust method for measuring. And what to measure? Is it the heat value you want to measure? Or the constitution, what you want to measure, that you have to decide. And I also believe that there may not be very, instruments on the cells, probably you might have to have a customized instrument to measure your signals. Then you have to draw some operating procedure, you have to provide for inspection and calibration level from DGHP, go to each and every field and see after 6 months or a year that how they have been calibrated, and if not, we ask them in our budgets that they do collect their then reporting requirements of that. Now this is a critical issue. Fortunately, you have no marketing also. Okay? You are tied up with a individual. So marketing is a huge subject and it can take one or two cases of provisioning. But here, fortunately, you don't have marketing issues. You have already identified who will use your syllabus. Now, of course, pricing is the important thing. Now, pricing can be done two ways. You can start from the resource that you have and calculate up to the point it is sold. Or you can do the reverse calculation also. You can start from the price you are selling and come down to the price of the syllabus. Now, we have done this exercise at Rachi with Mr. Joy and all. And there, what we found, that you have to protect the value of resources. So suppose you are thinking of 50 million tons of coal, you are awarding it to some contractor. So what is the price of that coal? But caveat is that the normal coal, you are in a position to extract it. This coal, probably commercially, cannot extract physically. So some discounting you have to give. Fortunately, that discounting is there. Then you have also to think about the reference price. Why? So for example, in this case, it's not the only syn gas that can be used for a particular product. There are alternatives available. You have got say, methane gas, you have got CBM gas, natural gas. So it should be competitive. It's not that it is very costly or very cheap. It has to be competitive. Then you also have to think about the price of product sold in the market. What is the product that you are selling in the market in your case? Probably you are giving this syn gas to some power generator. Right? So what is the price the electricity is being sold? So if your prices are so high that nobody can earn some profit in between, then your pricing is wrong. So you have to take all these factors together, and the most important point is the last one. This, and particularly it's a new thing. You cannot be very sure what I am talking today, what I am discussing today is the final thing. You give an opportunity to review yourself. And it is a very critical issue. So you should have a reviewing provision in your contract that, okay, after 2 years, the parties will sit together and review what should be done about the pricing. Okay, so can I skip? I think I have already covered half an hour. So these are the environmental issues that have to be taken care of. Here, the very interesting aspect is that, say, suppose your contractor violates the environmental aspect. So what is the tool in your hand? What can you do? Penalty. I don't think any contract has that kind of provision. The most I have seen, there are two stages of control. Either before entering into the contract, you have a requirement of permission. So this is the control. The second thing could be that you can threaten him with the stopping the corruption. But this is also not a foolproof system. There had been exceptions in the industry. But possibly of time in there, so I don't know. Now assignment, of course, it appears very simple thing, but this is an element of a business. Here you are entering from a controlled business to an open business. What it means that if you go for you purchase a share, you give the freedom that he can, you know, sell it. Similarly, if you are given some participating interest, you give him the freedom that if he wants to sell it and somebody wants to take it, you give him substantial freedom. This is the heart of your contract. As a matter of fact, in hydrocarbon industry, you give this facility that though government approval is required, but if government doesn't give you approval within 180 days, then it will be considered deemed. Okay, so much freedom. Now, termination, I will just say one thing. It appears being a regulator that you have a tendency, oh, okay, I will terminate your contract. Never do that. You will land up in a situation that your resource will be tied up for another 20 years. This is how that goes into court. So termination, you think at the very highest level of your organization. It should not be considered by anybody for any reason. Even I have seen that there have been false statements. I have the opportunity to terminate the contract. But from the business point of view, It's not the right decision. And finally, I will tell you, avoid all technical grounds for terminating a contract. Never, ever. Because otherwise, you will be losing, government will be losing, your contractor will lose, and that your asset will remain idle for God knows for how many years. Now, this is the last slide, probably, how revenue sharing can be done. In contract, you ask the contractor to bid for two elements. That is called the LRP, lower revenue point, and the higher revenue point. These two stages are determined by you. Say, for example, in exercise at Ranchi, we determine that the LRP will be 0.3 million cubic meter of gas per day. And as far as HRP is concerned, I think it was 0.8 million or something like that. So for these two values, you will ask the contractor how much percentage of your production or revenue you will share with the government. So he will give you a figure, say 20% LRP, 20% of the LRP, and he may give you another figure, any figure, what he feels comfortable with, say 30% at HRP. So these are the two information on which you evaluate the bid mostly. In our case, it had a weightage of about 80%. But now there is a guideline that it should be 50% this and 50% technical. But this is a very crucial aspect on which you are going to decide who will get the contract. And this is a formula which is written simply for any point on this slanting line. Say suppose your production is here, then what should be the percentage the contractor will share with the government? That you can find out from this. This is a step length. Nothing new. Not new.
It's the same.
Yeah.
Technology is not that much matured ki one can estimate ke how much revenue can be shared with government of India, government, because the no plant has reached this commercial stage. So in advance to decide ke how much one has to share, it is very difficult task, because some clues investor has to get.
See, the thing that you are saying, if it is so, you should not think about regulation, you should not think about contract.
Okay. At this
now
stage,
the second thing is that
not
add,
possible.
Let me add also. No, when you are going for contract, be very sure. So product
or
process
UCG,
is commercial.
I suppose this terms and conditions should be only up to pilot stage, not to commercial, because no plant is commercialized.
So that is
present.
That is what contradictory to what other people are saying actually. We have been called in for formulating policies, we have been called in for training contracts, and if you do that, you do only if your project is commercial.
You have to have some prior experience. For example, CBM. We have run so many pilot wells, then only we have come to the stage to, we can commit.
Let this decision be taken by the Ministry,
yeah,
but
Lochan sir,
this is
take care.
The only the
excuse me,
that
Mr. Singh.
Yes, sir.
Here I'm here. What Mr. Jain is trying to tell, he is trying to tell what are the conditions which he has already discussed with Ministry of Coal. I think it's more of an informative thing which he is giving. So I think we should listen to.
And actually, this graph comes to the end of. I think so. One more thing, just a very small thing, but it's very important from the contract point of view, that you should beforehand decide the seat of arbitration for dispute resolution. Sometimes in earlier contracts we had decided it would be Hague or London or Kuala Lumpur, and that made the whole of our life very difficult, and many of the decisions went against us. So I will advise you that you please keep it in New Delhi. I think that's the end of it.
Thanks, sir.